Good afternoon, and welcome to the Eastern Historical Society and Museum. Today, as you know, we're going to talk about the ice industry in Easton. But before we get to the main program, we're going to have a little surprise program today. It's not on, you didn't see it on the agenda, you wouldn't have seen it in publications, but it's very important. My name is Ken Michael. I'm the president of the society. Over here we have, for those who don't know, John Coe, who's the vice president and director. I'm sure most of you are aware that March is Women's National History Month. All the way from the 1st to the 31st, and back in 1980, there was a Women's National History Week, which was enacted by President Jimmy Carter. Later on, Congress in 1987 made it an entire month. It took them a few years to get around to it, but they finally got the message and they did it right. And this month's colors are purple, green, and white. And the theme of this month is Women Who Advocate for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. And I want to read something. I wanted to make something up, but I couldn't make up anything as good as what I'm about to read. And it's from President Jimmy Carter when he signed the Women's National History Week into proclamation. From the first settlers who came to our shores, from the first American Indian families who befriended them, men and women have worked together to build this nation. Too often, the women were unsung, and sometimes their contributions went unnoticed. True words. But the achievements, leadership, courage, and strength, and love of the women who built America was as vital as that of the men whose names we know so well. That was President Jimmy Carter. Today, the Eastern Historical Society and Museum honors with great appreciation the women who have and still do contribute to our success. And I'm going to start by introducing one of the women who's been most responsible for our success, the First Lady of the Eastern Historical Society and Museum, Hazel Burrell. And Steve Anderson is going to present Hazel with a bouquet. As close as we could come to the flowers for the colors for the month. And now, I know this is going to come as a surprise, ladies, but Hazel's not the only one being honored. Do you see the look of shock on their face? In no particular order of priority, but alphabetically, Nancy DeLuca, who is not here just yet, but she's going to get here, and when she does, she's going to be surprised. Ann Worcester Drury, who has to leave to go to her grandson's birthday party. She obviously has no sense of priorities. But we will start with Joanne England, who is our social media and website coordinator. And since I have no clue as to how any of that stuff works, I'm just going to call her the wizard.
Yeah. All right.
Next to Joanne is Ginny Moore. Ginny Moore is a new director, and she's been involved in a number of different programs since she came on, for which she takes charge. And in addition to taking charge, she gives orders. I know, because I've been following a lot of orders from Ginny for a very long time. You know, things like, get out of the way. What are you doing here? So, Ginny, thank you. And we also have with us today one of our longstanding directors, Deb Salisbury. And Deb has been involved in many, many facets of the society over the years, has been north of 20, and think about this, she's only 35. So, Debbie, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank Thank you very much. Let's see, has everybody got their flowers now? So I'm going to say to all of you, again, thank you. Thank you for all you do, all you have done, and all you continue to do. I'll also thank all of the women who are here today for everything they do, and all of the women who are our members and who will be watching this program on cable TV sometime in the near future. I regret that Nancy couldn't be here, but Nancy is our treasurer. She does a great job and keeps our financial well-being in mind and keeps John and I from spending too much money. Ann Worcester Drury is our... Ann Worcester Drury is our staff writer. Ann has just been fantastic. Yeah, I'm sure all of you have seen her bi-monthly writings and articles. I'd like to start quoting them, but there's so many of them and they're so good, you can't pick out one that's just the best. And secondly, she's also responsible for our quarterly newsletter, many copies of which are out in the front, and she's done a fantastic job. So while she's not here to hear this, I'm just going to say thank you, Ann, thank you, Jenny, and hopefully they'll see the cable TV program, but we will save the flowers for them. So I will personally deliver them. On that note, I'm going to turn the program over to our Vice President and Director, John Coe, who's going to tell you everything you need to know about the ice industry in East. Johnny?
All right, get out of there.
Thank you.
So good afternoon, everybody. Again, I'm Jonathan Coe, just a big crowd here today. Thank you for all for coming. Trying to get a new feature every month. It's kind of easy for us. There's so much history here that we could just put our finger on something. What do we want to, when did we do it last? And do we have artifacts here? Do we have pictures? Do we have files that have been produced for us from years past? Thanks to Hazel. She put everything in a box, I'll label it, and just make sure you keep it there for the future. And guess what? Good thing. So today is on the ice harvesting industry in Easton. And got some interesting pictures. If you please make sure that you do see these two showcases. A lot of them are from Monty's Ice House, which will feature. You're going to be seeing a 30-minute documentary put on, it was created and produced by Robert Holmes right here. Say hi, Robert. And that was about 20 years ago. His father-in-law, Robert Buddy Worcester, my old English teacher from Oliver Ames, which is, it's a great film. Matter of fact, I just watched the DVD, and we have a thumb drive. Steve gave me a thumb drive, and you'll also see this on ECAP. They're going to produce this when they make this film, and you'll all be on this too, so which is great. But that's it right here, and if you want to buy one to support the Historical Society, they're only $10. Take it with you. But we have some great artifacts, and you can see the tools that we've got here from the dungeon. It looks like it was a dungeon. They did some bad things down there, but there's some great tools that they used in the old days. And so we'll talk a little bit about that. I want to talk about Monty a little bit. And Monty's wasn't the only ice business in Easton. There was a few others before Fred Monty took over from the Brockton Ice and Coal off of Monty's Pond on Elm Street on the left. You can see the blue, I mean the brown sign there. It's fabulous. But there was a number of ice businesses here, and we had Long Pond had some ice businesses there. We actually have a nice right up there, Long Pond Ice Company. George DeWitt Sr. was the president. And George DeWitt Jr., you probably remember, if you're alive today, Jr., you probably remember, had the lumber yard on Park Street with Red DeWitt. So some great, great old pictures there from Long Pond. We had some close to Northeastern down here by Frothingham Park. Before Frothingham Park, there were two ponds there, and Mr. Goward had some livestock business there. He needed a nice house. He needed to have some ice, preserve the meat around. So Goward's had, it wasn't a commercial business, he did it for his own needs. There's a number of other ones. So Elm Street is Monty's. Horizontally, the next big street up there that goes to Brockton is Union Street. And up there on the left is a pond up there, and Bill Knapp, Sr., had a nice business up there. I didn't realize that until I did some research on that, which I've learned an awful lot. His telephone number was 783. You can tell how long ago that was. Just call 783. Or tell the operator to call 783. So that was a couple others. We had one, a couple on the Columbus Ave. J.J. Reardon Ice Company. Now that, I remember going to school with a Sean Reardon on North on Main Street going to Brockton on the right. Well, his dad, that was probably his great-grandfather, J.J. Reardon. We have a nice picture of his truck up here. J.J. Reardon, I think, is up on the, there's Knapp's, I think it's in the other showcase there. And then there was a Spillane, Frank Spillane bought it after him. So Flyaway had a business. Does anybody remember Flyaway Pond? Yeah, you remember that. Yeah. Great swimming hole, don't you love?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Pout Rock, anybody remember Pout Rock? You had to swim up the Pout Rock from the dam, if you can make it. So I just want to give a brief piece, and we'll get the movie going. But a little industry, talk about the ice industry and where it started from. Frederick Tudor was the, he started the big ice business from Boston. He actually started his first ice house in 1805. He was born in 1783, he died in 1864. You know, interestingly, there was an ice house at the White House. Did you know that? In 1802, Thomas Jefferson was there. He had an ice house. I think he likes things cold there, and probably kept a few things nice and fresh. But he had an ice house and backed up to a little hill. There was some things that Tudor had to start with. It was really about, you know, storage of ice. If I was going to cut it, what am I going to do with it? You know, how am I going to, you know, before it melts away and I want to do something with it and sell it, I need to store it. He tried all sorts of things to try to keep the ice from melting quickly. And he came up with the double wall, put the sawdust in there. I think a lot had hay, but sawdust was seemed to be one of the, he went through a lot of struggles to try to figure out which would be the best. So he was a big deal in storage. And the next big thing he had was transporting it before it melted. He was a big thinker about getting his ice to some places during the summer and before it melted. Funny story was that he and his brother William, they were going to go down to Martinique. He figured if I go there, I could sell some ice. It's hot down there. And he sent his brother to go down there and scout out the place and build an ice house. Because he was gonna have tons of it on a big ship. He's gonna go down there, go to the dock, unload it, get in the ice house and sell it all over the place. The Tudors were very, very well-to-do. His father was a prominent Bostonian, lots of money. Frederick went to Harvard at 13 years old. Right? Not for me, he said. I want to start the ice. I want to do something. This is boring stuff to me, he said. And so he sent his brother, William and Frederick. Actually, the father sent them down to Cuba and just to check out the place. He gave them $1,000 and they found out, you know what, gee, and maybe this is something we want to do with the ice business. But when he started getting into it, now he sent his brother to make, and get, build a nice house. They knew how to do it. So he got a ship, went down, brought it into port, found his brother waiting for him down there. And he said, "Hi, Bill, how you doing? So where's the ice house?" Bill wasn't that good about getting things done. And he says, "Well, I need to talk to you about that. Here is a shipload of ice." And Brother Bill didn't build any kind of a storage house. So where do you think that ice was? He had to sell it real quick off the boat. Let's put it that way. So that was a failed excursion. But he built some incredible ice houses down. They finally did it. And they sold, he had a great, great run down to the Caribbean. And he went from that, he went over to India. And there was a great, great ice house he built in Calcutta. And this is when he made a lot of money. He built one that the ice actually lasted for 5 years. So it was well insulated. So there's so many of these stories about Frederick Tudor. I don't want to bore you with all of that because there's so much, you know, when did refrigeration come in? It actually came in, you know, the beginning of the 1800s toward the 1840s, and they used ammonia as a refrigerant, and there was a big controversy there because now we had artificial ice being made, and ammonia leaked a little bit, but Tudor took advantage of that. Tudor said to people, because he knew this would ruin his business a little bit, he told the people out there, "Well, it's not, you know, it wasn't clear, the ice they made was not clear. It's just the way it freezes." But he told people that, "You know, ammonia's going to be in that ice and it's going to be poisoning you." So people didn't buy that stuff for a while until he kind of figured it out. And by the time the Civil War came around, he died in 1864, but there were some issues there with, you know, getting some ice to the south, getting it down there, there were embargoes and all that. So that was an interesting story about Frederick Tudor. I do want to tell you about an ice house in Easton. This would have been a huge one that never got built. So Langwater Farm, Fred's farm, Frederick Lothar Baines, he's ready to build the Gate Lodge. And Frederick had the Langwater Pond or Fred's Pond. So in the back pond, back of the bridge, he was going to build, by Richardson, by the way, an ice house. There was a project, and I'll have this up here to take a look at it if you like. But there was a beautiful design of an ice house, had a tower on it, had the ramps going up, that you take the ice up there, and a place off of Elm Street where somebody could bring the cart and buggy in and pick up their ice. Olmsted, it is said, it is rumored, that Olmsted had a discussion with Frederick Lothar Baines and said, "I don't think that's a good idea. You're going to ruin the whole looks of this whole place." And Mr. Ames agreed with him. So it was a nice house that never got built. That would have been a huge thing if you know the way they operated. So there's a J.J. A Reardon one. But so great. Again, welcome here. We are ready to show you. Hey, Charlotte, are you ready to do the DVD? You want to, she's our, by the way, I want to everybody welcome Charlotte to us. She is going to be a freshman at Oliver Ames next year. She walked in here about 3-4 weeks ago and said, "I would like to volunteer at the Easton Historical Society." So I want to welcome Charlotte to everybody here. When you see her here, she's doing a wonderful job. Hold on for 1 second. Hold on for 1 second. Ken? Where's Ken? Do we want to make a little presentation to the young lady that's right behind you? So one of our directors, all our directors, our women, have received some beautiful flowers. And Nancy DeLuca. Nancy, stay right there. And she's late. This isn't she's true. Late. She didn't punch in either. Did you punch in?
She didn't punch in.
I'm not late. The client's 12:15.
Yeah. I'm still waiting for the iPhone to click that thing over. And it hasn't done it yet.
Well, anyway, as I mentioned earlier,
One of our esteemed directors is Nancy DeLuca. She's also our treasurer. Nancy has arrived. If you all look to the back, she is. And please give her a round of applause. And as I said to all of our other lovely lady directors, thank you very much, Nancy, for all you do, because you do a great job, and we're most appreciative.
Thank you.
And somewhere out there is Steve Anderson, who's got...
In a minute.
Oh, he's not out there. No, sorry, Steve's not there. But Ken England will do the honors.
Where does Steve go?
Steve snuck into the audience. He figured, oh my God, I'm off the hook now, I can leave.
We're such a well-oiled
But
machine.
Anyways, just a well-oiled
Oh, machine. Look at, he's right here.
No, he's on the show.
He's not.
He sat down next to his wife. That's a smart move.
But Ken England, I'm sorry to present.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. Oh my goodness. Thank you.
Now I'll turn you back over to John.
So we're going to show the 30-minute documentary. It is fabulous, absolutely fabulous.
The dam, built on the north side of Elm Street about 1765, created what was to become Monty's Pond. It became a source of power for what was once an industrial site on the Dorchester Brook. About 1833, the old Leonard Place, which had produced the first steel in America, became the property of Calvin Marshall. The Marshalls, who harvested ice on the Elm Street site, may have been one of the earliest ice-cutting enterprises in New England. Brockton Ice and Coal later operated there until Fred J. Monty bought the property in 1927. He built huge ice houses and continued the ice farming business until 1967. The pond is still called Monty's Pond. Fred J. Monty was a man of independence, strength, and endurance, with a passion for the cold, often dangerous, hard work of ice farming.
Wool. It was all wool. Black and red checks. And he also wore these for hunting. And he had the same clothes. He didn't have a wardrobe as such. He had the shirts, red, black shirts, jackets, and the black wool pants. I never heard the guy say that he was cold. I mean, it could be -5, and he was always out there, wind and storm. As far as his clothes was concerned, what he wore, cutting ice, and but they were heavy. I mean, he fell in the pond a couple of times, and he had to come out like 350 pounds heavier than when he went in. Always laughed at all the guys who used to come up there because the way they dress. You know, they had this light jacket on and white pants, and they'd be the first ones back to the shanty, getting next to the potbelly stove.
The shanty, to my memory, was about 6 by 8 or 8 by 10, and he had a couch in there, I believe, and he had a rocking chair, and he used to sleep in the rocking chair that had two cushions on the bottom, cushions off of your old-fashioned sofas, and one in the back, and Fred used to just lay back and sleep in there with his pipe going. That's all that I remember him. When you went in there, it'd be about 95 degrees, and he'd have his pipe going and the wood stove going. You could hardly see or breathe.
He's always kind. I will say one thing, I suppose I got to bring it up. He had his own language, which somewhat rubbed off on me. But as a rule, he was very good to people. In fact, 90% of the people who probably came to cut ice had no idea what they were doing. It might be their first time. And Fred, if you ever saw any of the pictures, he was always showing somebody, do this, do this. And he'd guide them along, so finally by the end of the day, actually the people that were working there really knew what the job was, but his whole job was to follow everybody around, make sure they did the right job.
By accident, one day, I almost killed Fred. He put a board on top of the pole so he wouldn't split the pole, and Fred put the board too close to me and not on the edge of the pole. And when I hit the board, I hit it on the end, and the fulcrum lifted the board up and caught Fred under the chin. He went over backwards and landed on the ice and didn't move. I ran over and I was looking down at Fred, and all of a sudden the eyes opened, and the dark eyes, and before I knew it, he was on his feet cursing a blue streak. And people were pushing their children away, and like a mother hen and chicks, getting them off of the ice. And I was so happy to see that Fred was okay that I didn't even mind the cursing at that moment. But it wasn't always easy to get a crew of men to work in below freezing weather, long hours, hard work, and low pay. So, and the time, I mean, you had to work at short notice for 10 days or 2 weeks. I think I started working there when I was about 15. And Monty, as I recall, he treated me like I was a man. And I never forgot that. And I have a soft spot in my heart for Fred J. Monty to this day, because I was a boy and he treated me like a man, and I never forgot that.
In spring, the pond is emptied to be cleared and cleaned for next year's ice harvest.
Draining the pond, that was a thing. Usually in the spring, they would open the dam, let everything run down, and when the pond dried out in late summer, two or three men would be working out there all day with burners, like big blow torches, killing all the weeds that would grow so the ice could be clear the following winter. But before they drained, they would go upstream towards Knapp's Pond, and one year they put blue vitriol in the water, which is a chemical that retards growth. And then they drained the pond, and when it got dry enough, they would burn it. And that was a dirty, smoky job. You come home at night looking like a firefighter come from a woods fire.
Winter sets the stage for the actors and the actions of this production.
What would happen would be it would snow on the ice, and snow insulates it so it wouldn't set up as fast, and they would plow the ice off for that reason, and then they'd bore holes in it to flood it, and that way it would build up real fast, the ice.
The dawn of winter white silence. The pond awaits the first cutting.
But we started at 5 o'clock in the morning. It was still dark, and I remember the stars twinkling, and we would start working, and we had to start at 5 o'clock in the morning because we had to make sure the saws would start, and a man came to check the saws in the morning, and if the saw wouldn't start, he would put ether into the carburetor, but all he really had to do, this gentleman, was breathe in it, because it would have accomplished the same thing.
What they'd do, they'd start, they'd make a straight line, no matter where they were on the pond. Once they made that initial line, the ice cutter would cut probably within 2 to 4 inches of going actually through the ice. They could tell when he went actually through the ice because water would start to come up, and then they'd just raise the blade up, and if for some reason they didn't think they were deep enough, they could lower it down. So it was quite an art just to get that, but the first initial line was the one that really counted. Once they got that initial line, they had like outriggers. They more or less guided on that line. It was two things. It guided the line and guided them and keep the two men would run the ice cutter. And it would actually follow that line with these outriggers. Plus the outriggers were kind of to stabilize it too, in case it did rock or tried to fall through the ice, it would hold it up. There was one on either side. And they'd cut 22 inches from the first original line. Then they'd start and cut across these lines, making it 44 inches. So actually a cake of ice, it was 22 by 44.
And after the cuts were made, before you could break them off, you had to keep the water from coming back into where the cuts were made. So you had to go along all the seams, scrape
the snow
that came from the saw blade, and just with a flat bar that just fit in, tamp it down. One job, just stand there, move over 24 inches, move over, it would make a long day.
Actually, after the ice cutter cut, you had to take hand saws. There again, you'd say you'd want to float maybe 100, 300 cakes, and you'd actually take a big, enormous hand saw, and the motion of that was actually a rotating motion. You couldn't saw it just like a piece of wood. In fact, we had some real strong men down there that just couldn't get in the rhythm. What it would do would cut out a great big float. By the time a day came, noontime came, I got to tell you, your shoulders were falling off. The hand sawing was the initial part that got everything separated from the whole pond device.
The journey to the ice house begins as the floats move up the channel.
The float at 20 by 40 would be started off, and then as you got closer to the channel, they would be barred off into rows. And then as they got even closer, they were barred off into doubles, and then they were barred off into singles. And what barred them off was a needle bar, just like a giant ice pick, and a couple of cuts in the cracks with the needle bars, and the float bars would come right off.
On the floats, there was many a float that you'd have 100 cakes, even 300 cakes. You could get away from where you just cut, found yourself out in the middle and not moving. And there you are, one or two people standing there, say up to 200, 300 cakes of ice. And the only way out of that is you hope you had the longest pipe pole. There were some real long ones made, so you could reach the bottom and actually push it, because you'd actually be stranded there. There was a few times that somebody would have to go out with a smaller float and get you going again, because you could actually stand still.
It was kind of warm out, it was getting warm, and there was a kid down there, they called him the cowboy, he always had a hat. He had a fall on the shore with a pike. He started across, the field is all open pretty well, he started across through the middle of it, pulling it across to something, which he shouldn't have been doing. And all of a sudden that flow cut, broke in half, right? Then he was on the other smaller half, on the biggest half, then that broke again. He got down to 4 cakes, I think, and all of a sudden them 4 cakes broke up and he just dove in.
On their frozen journey, blocks of ice ascend the sluiceway.
Ice came in, was needle barred off, so you'd end up with a 22 by 44 cake, single cake. Actually, before it got onto the chain, it was kind of guided into the chain. The chain had spaces with big blocks of oak wood, so that it would take a single cake of ice. As they're coming up the chain, they actually went through a shaver. There was 3, 4 of them at times. And what they did, is take the ice down to 12 inches.
They most of the time took off any junk ice, like snow ice or anything like that, because it wasn't good. They had two big Buick motors in that shed. One was pulling the chain, the other one was pumping a pump with an intake that big around.
Yeah.
Be pulling off from the lake, and it would be driving them chips through metal troughs,
yeah,
back out into the water again, and that thing was just running all day like that. It would run when they would shave and lot.
Once in a while, a cake might try to turn sideways, and one would try to piggyback over another. And there was always somebody right at that very point where the cake would go up onto the chain. And they had a bell there, and this bell was actually to the operator. It was way up on top. The man who was ever operating that up there, which was kind of by himself, he was out of the whole operation, but he had a real important job. He would automatically stop the chain.
One individual that worked up there, I went up to see him one day, and it was just a pine board shack, no heat, the bottom was open, the wind whistled through there. That was colder than working out on the pond.
My neighbor, Red Lundgren, used to work up in that wheelhouse, or whatever you'd call it, and Fred used to call him Reddy Red. And he said, I don't want these young fellas up there because they don't know how to run that clutch. He says, I want you up there, Red. And Red would say, well, I'm freezing to death. He says, I can't stand it any longer. So they'd warm him up down to the shanty, and then he'd go back up there and he'd do his job again.
Set by calculations, the blocks move along the galley.
Once the ice would be put onto the chain, it would take it up to a certain height, whichever the ramps were set at, which they'd raise these ramps as the houses were being filled, and it would release off and then go gravity down to the different rooms in the house.
They raised the galley probably about 4 feet. They couldn't raise it too much because as the cakes would be switched into the ice house, if the run became too steep, the guys wouldn't be able to control it. So you had to be under a controlled set of circumstances. So about 4 feet, 4 to 5 feet would be enough so that the guys could get the ice in there under a gravity situation. And a lot of times they put lags in the runs. And if it was steep enough to come down too fast, they'd raise the lags up, slow the ice down a little bit, all right, and then they'd be able to handle it into the houses. And then they would raise the galley as the houses came up. I'm thinking back now, you have this galley, God knows how much it would weigh, and you have this winch, and this, you know, there's two guys cranking this winch up, and the weight of the galley, and if somebody lost it, you know, without putting that cog back in, you know, down it would come, and that would be a total disaster. And thank God, you know, nothing like that ever happened.
The switcher would be up sitting on the run. And there again, the size was immaterial, because if you grabbed that cake of ice the wrong way, say 300, 350 pounds coming down, if you grabbed it wrong with a pipe pole, that would pull you right down the rung, you'd go right past the next guy's house.
The pike had to be stuck into the middle of the back of the bar of ice, a few inches from the edge, just as it went about two-thirds of the way past you. And then you could swing it into the ice house, and it went down a chute to the floor. If you hit it too close to one edge or the other, it would get jammed in the doorway, and then the next bar of ice hit it, and there would either be a backup or broken ice, or sometimes the bar would just keep right on going with the pike in it down the galley or with the person attached to it.
A lot of times a cake of ice come up, it might break. Or there was a possibility, say if you were on the end house and you missed a cake, that cake would actually go off the end. And right at Elm Street, right at the very end, in the end of the ice house and the runs, there was an enormous ice pile. It just kept growing every day. It'd be half cakes, quarter cakes. Once in a while a free cake would get by, but it was very seldom. And there was always a big sign, no parking. That was right near the ice pile, which is right at the edge of the road. You know, it's kind of foolish to park there because this ice, once it comes down, say it could be 20 feet high, come down a banking on a, like sliding off a pyramid, See, when one day it was a four-door sedan, I believe it was a Cadillac, hit it right between the doorpost. The car completely, the other side of the car came on the passenger side and actually bulged out the driver's side, so the car was actually totaled.
The ride along the galley ends as the cakes are switched to be channeled into the house for stacking.
But once the spire of ice got into the room, I believe, if I recall correctly, as the bars were 44 by 22, one floor would be laid with the 22s in one direction, and then the next floor would be alternated so that they were on top of the bars the opposite way, and the bars couldn't touch. And all this had to be done rapidly. The bars would be very close together but didn't touch, and then they alternated back and forth, because come next summer or spring, they had to be broken out of there easily, and if they were all touching or put in there wrong, it would be a multi-thousand ton block of ice which couldn't be used. And it was very important that the skilled people, and the most skilled and agile people, were usually in the houses.
What I remember is it was like you said, it was like a team, and they didn't want to trust anybody else with their legs. I think it was the biggest problem, you know, broken legs and things like that. But there was also a competition that used to develop between a lot of the houses. You know, who's better than who, and all that. I mean, they get along great. I mean, it was a great place to work up in the galley, and a lot of fun.
Usually four men in a room, and there was a great clamor for people who wanted to work in with Johnny Farrell, who had the cider mill and had the ice and oil business. Once they found out that John used to bring up hard cider with him every day, and when things get going hot and heavy, they always were putting more ice in there, and you know, with a little artificial inspiration, you can do a lot more work than you usually do.
When they get full, as I remember it, they would be covered with hay, at least those six houses. And they would have to basically start the operation again, because across from the six houses, there were another three. And instead of switching them into the house, they would have to push them down these runs across this road that separated the two houses. And the process would start again. They would start filling these houses up, and the galley would start coming up as they were filled.
Construction of the ice house, they were double-walled, and sawdust was put in between the walls for insulation, an old Yankee insulation. And up in the top of each and every room, there were big racks where hay was stacked. And every summer, they'd renew the hay. And when they get all done bringing the ice in, they take the hay out of the racks and spread it all over the ice to insulate it so that it would stay until summertime.
The system actually worked great. Nowadays, it'd be hard to believe if you could maybe get that many people together, it would work that close together. But back then, it really worked and was to everybody's benefit.
Ice is delivered out of trucks and trailers in such opposite directions as Cape Cod and New Hampshire.
Inside the trailer doors, Fred had his trucks with a timber across at each level to keep the thing from shifting. And they were pretty good. They were packed in pretty tight. And it would be so cold inside, they would adhere some.
I said, drove that truck, that Ford truck, was a ton and a half Ford truck. And Louis Otten was telling me they'd put 11 ton on that truck. Imagine that. Fred had it beefed up and everything. It would go out of there and go to Stoughton, to Randolph.
At one point, Monty had a contract with Hood Milk, but they also had a big plant down in Hyannis. And they took a lot of ice, especially during the vacation season. For a 12-hour day, it was loading trailers, and they'd all go down to Hyannis to supply Hood's milk. And they would all be weighed on the scales that were outside the shanty before they left. So on a hot summer day, you could follow one of those trailers down the road, and you'd see the water running out. But that was Hood's ice that was running out the door. It wasn't Fred Monty's money running out the door.
Some people set their vacation when Monty started cutting. Some people were unemployed anyway. Many people were retired. You would get occasional reprobates or something like that in the crew, but quite often you got retired men, farmers who could adjust their schedule, young people, truck drivers like Edgar Packard and Buddy Packard, and sometimes Herbie Packard would drive, and there were retired truck drivers there like Eddie Dawes, and regulars like the Mellows. The Mellows were farmers from down Bristol County way, and they came up and they worked like crazy. They milked their herd before they came up. They were up there at 5 o'clock in the morning. They put in their 8-hour day and they shot right back down to the dairy farm and did their milks. And as I recall, they were one of the crews for this, one of the rooms laying the floors.
Al Reed was a loyal employee over a long period of time. Reliable and efficient, he became a vital part of the ice harvesting operation.
Al was like a second father to me. He always gave me enough rope just to stop me from getting into trouble, and then he'd start pulling it back in. And I'm sure that was a challenge from not only did the guy work extremely hard, he had to babysit me for quite a few years. And Al was opposite of Fred. He was not excitable that I ever saw. You wouldn't see him running around crazy. All of a sudden you turn around and the job was complete. It was just done. Yeah, he was an amazing guy. I don't know how he stayed that long with Fred, because they were, well, I don't know, opposites track, I guess. But he was a great guy.
One man that I thought of earlier today was George Dink Bigney, who was a fixture there since Hannah was a pup.
George Bigney and Fred Monty were partners in an ice business in Brockton long before Fred bought Monty's pond and became an ice man there.
And many times, the people that know Bud Bigney, who drove for Fred, would see Fred's truck by the side of the road, and Buddy had stopped, whether it was to get lunch or what. You would see the water running down the street, whether it was up at Unionville or up in Stoughton or down at the Bourne Rotary.
Yeah, as a kid, I used to ride with Buddy a lot of times on those trips. First off of the Union Villa.
At age 71, Fred J. Monty sold his business, buildings, land, and rights to Oliver F. Ames. The deed of sale, recorded on April 1, 1966, marked the official end of the last ice house in New England. Within several years, the buildings were demolished and removed. The dam was broken down.
When Oliver F. Ames acquired the property from Fred Monty and everything, and why the dam had to be torn down, they had people had forgot to monitor the water level, the raise and lower the depth, and they had, I think it was in 67, and they had an awful rain, and the water got so high in the pond that it washed over the top and took some of the big huge rocks the size of this table off the back side. And that's when the environmentalists came down the street, and they were afraid of it. If the dam let go, it would naturally wash out Elm Street and all the way down through that valley through Bigney's Pond, and contacted Mr. Benson to come down and start dismantling it, just for that liability factor.
Thus, in Easton, Massachusetts, in the village of Unionville, on Elm Street, at Monty's Pond, an era ended and passed into history. So we leave Unionville and the corner of the dark corner. Briefly, we have frozen time like a cake of ice. But ice melts, water flows, and time passes inexorably. Knowing this, we have attempted to capture a moment of a bygone era. Our chroniclers have recalled it truthfully, fondly, and faithfully. The Dorchester Brook flows on. So does that other stream, the stream of time. If we look through the right lens, we may notice along the bank of that second stream a lone figure, moving away from a pond that bears his name on its final journey to the last ice house.
Shaver. This would help get all the ice nice and straight and flat.
This is a nice bike, all of a flow of ice, pulling it, turning around, pushing it. It's very sharp. You didn't go pounding on rocks or anything without getting into some deep trouble.
This is the saw that they use when they want to cut off a float of ice from the field. You would have to take this and cut through the final edges. And it was done in a circular motion to go forward like this and let it drop and pull back.
Right, this is an ice packer. This is used after the ice cutter cuts the ice. It would actually tamp the loose snow and the ice into the crack so to keep actually the float kind of solid so that it wouldn't break up.
The ice tongs that they use to pick up like a 50-pound weight of ice and deliver it to your house, or if you had it in the refrigerator and you had to move it around, you'd use something like this in order to move it around.
It is, in fact, is a giant ice pick. And sometimes you would give it a fierce blow when only a light one was needed, and the needle bar would slip out of your hands and go into the drink. And if that happened, you were in trouble with Mr. Monty.
What do you think? That's pretty good.
Yeah. Right.
I just want to mention a couple things, which I forgot earlier. Monty's pawn was highlighted in Yankee Magazine. It was an article in January of 1966. We have a copy and the article right back there. And it, quite frankly, is a wonderful copy. And please take a look at that. Also, we actually have in our tools, our implements, we have a pipe pole, a long one upstairs. I didn't bring it down here because this is the same thing, it's just short. We have a pipe pole that's on in the other section, in the industrial section, above the windows. It's from the Josiah Keith house. The 1717 oldest house in Easton, they found it in the shed out back. Now there's a pond behind there, or old pond, but I don't know where he was using it, but when you see it, that is an antique. I mean, the wood is like this. He got it from a branch out there. So that is an amazing pipe pole. So I want you to know about that. Lastly, before I say goodbye, Nancy Worcester Holmes, right here, raise your hand. She's donated some wonderful baked goods. She's in the bakery business. And my rumor has it, she is supplying Langwater Farms. Am I right on that?
I work at the farmer's market.
Yeah, okay. So some beautiful little goodies back there, so you may want to rush up there and grab some because they look awful. Paul told me to make sure I get one for her. Great refreshments up there, free of course. So thank you all for coming, and please enjoy the rest of the day. We've got popcorn in the other, you can probably smell it from here, in the other room. And please enjoy the rest of the day, ask any questions. We've got two workers here that worked at Monty's. Ray Morrell and Tim Manning, raise your hand. Tim Marshall.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, that's Tim Manning. So they work there, so if you really want to know something about these implements, they are the pros. Okay, so ask them. So have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you.